All right, so we're going to go ahead and get started. So welcome. Good morning. Yeah. Thank you guys very much for coming. We are here today to tell you some unbelievable tales in analytics. And I've got with me presenting Joe and Wendy, who are two of my incredible colleagues. And I got to tell you a little bit about them. And it really kind of resonated with me this morning in the keynote when they, Dubner suggested that you should work with a genius. We have a genius, and her name is Wendy. She's an incredible data scientist, and I'm not saying that Joe is not a genius. He's an incredibly well-respected finance leader, but he's more well-known for, you know, impersonating Elvis and depositing money at the craps table. So. But I'm sure you'll enjoy listening to them as well. So let me explain a little bit about how this session is going to work. So we couldn't decide what we wanted to talk about this year, so we decided that it would be really fun to tell you some different stories about our success with Tableau at Honeywell. So the first story is a story about how we achieved results by tackling inventory. Okay. The second and the third stories are all about how self-service people in the business use Tableau and work with data. And so they'll be sharing how they've been able to overcome some data obstacles. And then the fourth story is really all about the science or how a data scientist goes through the cycle of what they do in their everyday and use Tableau. So we thought that would be a really kind of an interesting mix, but we'll see where it takes us. But first I'm going to share a little bit about what Honeywell does. So most of you probably know we are a Fortune 100, excuse me, I think we're a Fortune 67, something like that. And so we're pretty big. We're about 40 billion. That's kind of big. And one cool thing is we operate in almost 70 countries in the world. And we have 1,300 sites, of which I think we have more than 300 factories, something like that, and the rest are like sales offices and other offices. We're basically all over the world with our 130-ish thousand employees. But instead of going through a real detailed list of what we do, I'm going to tell you a story about one of our businesses. And this is our what we call our UOP business, which stands for United Oil Products. And we acquired this business, I think, in the early 2000 timeframe. But this business was formed in 1914. And it was formed to really commercialize on some inventions and patents that had been developed to demulsify oil. And what the heck does that mean? So what it means, when you take a barrel of oil and you need to make products like gasoline and diesel fuel and heating fuel, when you need to separate that barrel of oil into its various different products. So what that patent did was it actually enabled that separation process to create 30% gasoline, which was four times more gas than we could ever produce before that. So it was a pretty amazing invention and patent. So fast forward 100 years-ish, right? Clearly a lot of industry experience. So part of what UOP does today, and I'm going to really simplify this because I'm a finance background. This is really stretching for me. But this is such a cool business. We actually create what I'm going to call a blueprint for an oil refinery. So if you go to build an oil refinery, you need to know what you want to separate that barrel of oil into. And you need to essentially have that blueprint to create that refinery. So we make those blueprints, and then we make the catalyst, or the chemical, that mixes with the barrel of oil, that helps it optimize whatever the refinery wants to mix. Okay? But then this is the cool part that is really kind of more analytics focused, and I'm telling you this because it's going to resonate with you when Wendy comes up here. But essentially, we stream the data from the refineries back to the Honeywell cloud. Okay, this whole Internet of Things. We take that data and we analyze it with our 100-plus years of experience, and we make recommendations to the refineries so that they can operate more effectively and more efficiently. And ultimately, this is where we get to keeping plants running and keeping workers safer, because we clearly don't want anything to happen there. Okay, makes sense? All right. So, that's a little bit about Honeywell. That's our story. So let me jump into what kind of usage we've had here at Honeywell and Tableau. The last time I looked, we had 18,205 users, and we are, you know, almost, we're 2 months away from our 2-year end of our deployment, and we should have between 20 and 21,000 people based on the rate that we're growing on Tableau Server, which is pretty incredible. I don't know if you saw those bubbles come in, but on the map, you can clearly see that we have people all over the world. Remember I said we had 70 countries? Looks like about 70 bubbles on that chart. Lots of people everywhere using Tableau. We thought this would be also interesting to share a little bit about our user adoption based on which businesses, the one on the, let's see, do I know my right from my left? The one on the left is business groups, and the one on the right is our functions. So you can see that across all of Honeywell, we've had incredible adoption in all of our businesses and groups. And I'll attribute some of the aerospace success in Tableau deployment to Joe. So you'll hear a little bit about his stories, and he is in finance. So thanks, Joe, for making us on top on both sides. All right. So I'm going to tell the first story, which is all about tackling inventory. Now, any good fisherman would tell you that he needs tackle, right? You need lures, and you need weights, and you need all this, you know, stuff that I won't touch. And I don't touch fish. I love fishing, but I don't touch them. They're too slimy. But anyway, so we're going to talk a little bit about how we tackled inventory. And I'm also going to tell you another little story here that I know for one person in the audience that is also a CFO will very much appreciate. So picture this. The president of Honeywell calls up one of the presidents of one of our business units on a weekend, it was on a Sunday, and says, your inventory results are not good. You need to tell me, you know, what you're going to do to improve them. And by the way, he's really familiar with this business, and he said, I want to know about what you're doing with X, Y, and Z products, getting into really detailed levels. So what does that president do? Well, he calls finance, right? He calls the CFO and says, hi, what are the numbers? And how can we need to send an answer to the president. Well, where was the CFO on Sunday? At church. Where are you supposed to be? So there was this whole series of events that happened, and so the CFO is telling me that he's in the parking lot at church trying to get together the information that he needed. And that was kind of the tipping point. And we don't want anybody doing that at Honeywell. That's not appropriate, right? So he said, okay, this is it. We are going to do something different. And here's, hopefully that, you can get the gist of what the business challenges were. They had high inventory. They wanted to limit the they had limited visibility and want to increase the visibility. They couldn't see all the way down and answer those lower level questions. And they needed to do something about it, not just answer the questions. They need to make an impact. Okay? So the first thing that the CFO did was he actually talked to the president and said, hey, will you help us really try to sponsor a project here that is going to be really different and meaningful? We're going to try this new tool, and you know, we're not too sure how it works yet, but we're going to figure it out. And the president said, absolutely, yes. Whatever I need to do, I will help you. Okay? So the CFO formed a steering committee with IT, and together they set out to try to improve this and to drive these results in inventory. So of course, we have the typical problems that you see, right? We have silos of data and reports, and people in different functions typically look at the same information, but they might cut and slice and dice it in different ways. So you don't know if one group is looking at the same data as the second group. They have multiple sources of information, but not enough detail. We have so much data in Honeywell, it's incredible. And the reports, they came out too late. They came out after, you know, we got to go through month-end close. Oh, that's not actionable. And there are just too many of them. We had over 20 reports in this group. So they set out on this journey to really reduce the amount of effort to create all those reports that were, you know, late and not as effective as they could be. And really try to drive that one source of the truth so that people knew that when somebody in the supply chain organization was looking at the data, that finance would also understand what they were looking at. And they really wanted to make it more actionable and add more context to the data so that they can drive accountability and ownership. And then lastly, they wanted to make it easy to access and part of the process. So they didn't want to have to be the middleman anymore. Finance is tired of being the middleman. Okay, so that was really the objectives. So they set out on a phased approach. They didn't try to tackle everything at once because they were new to Tableau. So in the existing situation, again, they had, you know, Excel gymnastics, same thing that you guys see every day. 20 plus worksheets, a lot of data manipulation happening. So the first phase, they said, well, what should we do to try to increase adoption? And this part was actually quite brilliant on the CFO's part. He said, well, let's make sure that in every project that we charter, we have an objective of either introducing new information or really demonstrating a significant amount of productivity. So in this case, they said, all right, we're going to introduce new information. So they did that. They introduced a level of detail that hadn't been available before. And they introduced visualization of the data and enabled self-service so that every function could go in and take a look at this information. And it was a super easy to search dashboard. And it wasn't anything really spectacular. They took just baby steps to get there. And now on the next phase, that phase was very powerful for them because they were able to really answer a lot more questions than they could before. But it didn't get them quite to the action that they really wanted. So the next phase, they thought about, well, what do we need to do to take actions? And one of the things is to pair up that inventory with the demand, with forecasted demand. So they added another set of data, and they created more, and this is where they got better at Tableau, right? They created more action-oriented views, and they extended the people who could see this data to the sales team. So the sales team can go in now, and they can see where they had excess inventory and where they, you know, where they had, where demand was more than supply and where they had supply that needed some demand. So they were able to go out and take action where there was excess inventory and go out and sell inventory. And I'm going to share with you at the end how much that was, but it was awesome. So one of the other really, really good practices that this team did was they implemented this into their, what we call our MOS, which is the monthly operating system. They embedded these visualizations into their processes. I mean, it wasn't inside of software, but when they have reviews, they're using this information. So you can see on here that they clearly laid out which business processes they were going to use this data. And they clearly identified which reports were the validated ones that they needed to use. So everyone is clear what data to use and when. And as you can see, there's multiple functions on there. Production schedule, weekly reviews. They're using it at the production schedule level, okay? Relative to the monthly build schedule reviewed by finance. Okay, so there's lots of different examples on there. And leadership really helped. So the president of the organization, she makes sure that she uses this. And by the way, she loves data. So she uses this like crazy. She told me that she sits down with the sales teams and has them pull this up and ask, how are you going to make those sales calls for this inventory? So she's been very supportive. Okay. All right, so what did we learn? What is the moral of this story? The sponsorship was absolutely key. We had the president and the CFO leading this initiative, and they were instrumental in being able to get it done. We added some new capabilities. We didn't just recreate something that was already being created, and that made it easier to gain adoption. They iterated with the business, so as they went through their process, they got more and more feedback about what kind of information they needed. And it was okay that they just delivered in increments. In fact, now they're looking at more predictive analytics to embed in there. So their thinking is getting more progressively advanced as well. And they made it part of their process. Because when you're already doing something, you don't want to go over here and look at something else. And I think that's a really critical part of how to improve adoption. So the last moral of the story is this business actually was able to sell $10 million worth of op income of incremental inventory. That's incredible. That is an absolutely incredible result. And it seems very simple, but it was extremely impactful. All right, so now I'm going to pass things over to Joe, and he's going to share our next story.
Thanks, Sherry. I'm Joe Majeski. I'm a finance director in our Honeywell aerospace business. Make that clear. I'm in finance, not in IT. I don't have an IT background. Some may say, are you sure you even have a finance background? But I'm in finance. And I have a team that is focused on delivering standard reporting, driving productivity for finance and our business members, and then also enhanced analytics. So today what I want to do is I'm going to share two stories about how we work with data. This first one is with custom SQL. Now, at Honeywell, our CFOs say that we didn't go to school and become finance professionals to develop manual, repetitive reports in Excel. Instead, we want to be better business partners, driving insightful analytics and helping make impactful business decisions. And in fact, we have a group that we created that is focused on delivering enterprise-wide standard reports to get us out of the Excel manipulation. The idea is that with these enterprise-wide reports, we can mitigate or eliminate a lot of the manual Excel reporting that finance does today and distributes through the multiple mediums to our business partners. And I brought a couple of them to share with you today. So a couple samples. This is one that allows us to see profitability by business segment, by product line, and even by customer segment. We have a standard P&L. Can't get rid of the rows and columns, so we had to deliver a standard P&L. And again, we can see this across all of our businesses and then at the multiple levels within our business. And then we have our tried and true department expense report. And again, we can see costs across all of our functions and then all the elements of cost for those specific departments. And of course, all three of these reports that I have here, they have the ability to compare against multiple scenarios, prior years, actuals, AOP, forecasts. So when we looked at these reports, we saw the opportunity was huge to drive productivity throughout not only our finance organization, but within our business customers, driving that self-service, direct access reporting. We had a problem. Performance was slow. Now, within for Honeywell Aerospace, we are a defense customer, so we have to ensure that we have strict guidelines and rules, follow certain rules on who can access what data. So for us, it was important that we leveraged our HANA data warehouse. It's a governed data source, and we know that that's where we want to go. We already have role security set up. But the problem was that when we first deployed HANA, we were early onto the bandwagon, we deployed it, IT was still learning, and our views contain massive amounts of data. We published those views to Tableau server in the last 2 years, and it provides great information, they just chug along. So we had to do something different. So what we did was we started to leverage extracts. I'm sure like many of you, if this is your first Tableau conference, I'm sure you've heard it in one or two customer sessions already. If this is not your first Tableau conference, then you've obviously have heard it and are probably using extracts. Well, we quickly started to play with custom SQL. And we heard about it at Tableau conference. We did some research on our own. And it's an inherent ability in Tableau. And the great thing about the custom SQL was it allowed us to go into that SQL statement and identify the columns that we didn't need. I mean, it's data that we're not using in our workbooks. Or we look for the columns that caused our data sets to grow exponentially. And we removed them. But that wasn't good enough for the reports that we were trying to deploy. We needed more. So we had to add where and union statements. Now, if anyone out there is going, that's great, Joe, I'm not in IT, I have no clue how to do this. Remember, I'm not either, we're finance. But I'll let you in a little secret. Like much of baseball, we cheated. So what we did was, we actually went to business objects and we looked at some of the reports that had similar information and we just flipped it to the SQL code to get some insights that we could then leverage within Tableau. Now, we did talk with some of our IT friends, but never did we create an IT project. And as we became more sophisticated on unions, from there, it was a trial and error learning experience. And let me tell you, it was worth it. Because, again, we didn't have an IT project. It was something that my team did within finance, and we were able to improve performance significantly on these reports, helping us achieve our goal of getting dashboards to refresh in 5 seconds or less. In some cases, we had reports that were taking 2 to 3 minutes to run, and now they're down underneath 15 seconds. I still get some grief from my CFO on that, but I'm like, it's not 2.5 minutes. So definitely impactful. Now, some of the considerations that you had to be wary of is, now I'm using an extract. I'm not leveraging my HANA security as I initially intended, so I have to manage security in Tableau. Certainly, data is continuously a concern. We don't want to have too much. and we have to maintain our refresh schedules. Now, the one thing that we also learned as we began to expand on our use of custom SQL is that we were unable to blend our non-HANA data sources with our HANA SQL. So if that's something that you need to do, you have to find a different path to overcome that. But in the end, we were able to use our custom SQL through Tableau, create an extract on server, and then connect our existing workbooks up to that, and then deploy it with a lot of success. And as you saw from those slides earlier, a lot of adoption. Remember finance and then aerospace. We were the top ones. Woo-hoo! So, you know, in the end, leveraging our governed data set is important for us, and it should be for everybody else. So wanting to go to the HANA data sources are always our first priority. Trying to develop solutions that are low administration, second priority. We've learned that there are multiple ways to solve your data and performance needs. You just have to be flexible, curious, and then also just be diligent about doing some of that research and then trying it to see what works for you. And yes, custom SQL is possible for non-IT savvy folks like us in finance. So, I mean, again, this was great because those reports that you saw earlier, we were able to deploy those. They're now being referenced by business leaders. We have second iterations coming along where we actually have some of our folks from the dedicated team here now from India that are meeting with our business leaders doing OVOCs on the next generation of those reports. So it's a great way for us to really advance our self-service and direct access initiatives across all of Honeywell. And the second story I'm going to talk about, we actually use Alteryx. And this business case actually won the Alteryx Analytics Award this year back in June at Alteryx's conference. So if any of you are familiar with the movie Grumpier Old Men with Jack Lemmon and Walter Matthau, they're fishermen. And like any fisherman, they want to catch the big fish. And for them, that was Catfish Hunter. And Catfish Hunter was that uncatchable fish, that fish that was the trophy of the bottom feeders. And for Honeywell Aerospace, our quarterly forecast was our Catfish Hunter. It was a quarterly forecast for revenue and margin that we reviewed and updated every week with weekly meetings with our business leaders. The problem was that it took a lot to put it together. And with changes in our organization, reorganizations, changes in business leadership, what they were looking for was just more information, different slices of the data. And utilizing Excel and PowerPoint makes that very difficult to do it efficiently. We had analysts spending over 15 hours every weekend preparing the data for these early morning meetings. It wasn't good. And we think about the challenges that we had. We were using S-Space to house our forecast data, so they had to pull that out. They had commentary files from over 40 businesses globally, and they had to coordinate that. And then, obviously, we wanted to see comparisons. I mean, again, we are finance, and we are still somewhat antiquated, so we still are rearview mirror looking often. And they wanted to see that as well. So what we did, or actually what they were doing was, they were stuck in the Excel and PowerPoint nightmares, right? So again, they're working countless hours over the weekend to get these reports together. Of course, they're error prone. We had business leaders and CFOs working Sunday night to try and prep for those early morning meetings. And then you can guess how those morning meetings went. The first and second level questions were answered, but anything below that, they had the follow-up later because the reports were static, right? And it took us, you know, 90% of the time just to get the data, and no one had enough time to actually understand it. So what we did was we leveraged Tableau, and we developed self-service forecasting dashboards. What we did here, though, was we not only did we focus on the dashboards, but we really more focused on the process. And here we utilized Alteryx. We grabbed extracts from our HANA data source. We grabbed extracts from Essbase for our forecast, and then we took additional files and blended it all together, published a data source on Tableau server, and then developed these reports. And what's great about these reports is that we solved the number one critique that we've had or we receive when we deploy Tableau, actually number one next to performance. Can anyone guess what that is? It's commentary. Everybody wants commentary. They have it in PowerPoint, they have it in Excel. And because they were already doing that and trying to work through it, it was easy for us to pull that into our workflow. We had to make the connection so we could do the blending, and then we just created the process and brought that through. And now we have business leaders that can look and see a variance, and then they can see they slide down, and they can see that that ties to the summary of their comments. And not only do they have comments for variances, they have comments for risks and opportunities. And then they can go back and compare that to the prior forecast, or they can look at what that forecast is compared to our AOP. And it's great for helping them in those meetings. So again, with Alteryx, we're able to manipulate the data prior to getting it into Tableau, allowing us to use Tableau for what it's suited to do, and that's visualize the data. It allowed us to rapidly deploy this solution without IT. This one, it took us 3 weeks, and we had immediate adoption. We also were able to leverage governed data. Considerations are going to be similar that with custom SQL or really any extract. You got to have security on Tableau server. You're going to have to maintain refresh schedules. And then for us, we actually needed to get the data out of HANA because our Alteryx server didn't have a direct connection to the HANA tables. We actually utilized business objects to extract that information. So because I've talked about security, I thought I'd share this as well. We leveraged, for our extracts here, we leveraged Tableau's dimensional filters to create row-level security that mirrors the same security roles that we have in our HANA data warehouse. So now we can feel confident that only the appropriate people are seeing the data that they need. So in the end, we had widespread adoption, making these workbooks the number one workbooks across all of Honeywell. The reason why is that we didn't just give them what they were looking for, we gave them something more. We gave them something that was timely and was interactive. Remember those meetings where they only got to the first and second level questions? That doesn't happen anymore because they're actually using that, those workbooks live in those meetings. We have business leaders that are better prepared because our workflow is running constantly throughout the week. So as we have analysts updating that forecast in preparation for that meeting, leaders can go in there and they can look at it and they can quickly see what's changed from that prior week. And then they can make more efficient and quick decisions. The other thing that was interesting is that within Honeywell, not many people are using business objects for reporting. In finance, they're extracting the data and putting it into Excel to do the reporting. And we saw that as an opportunity as well. And it actually works really well because we can schedule our Webby reports, we'll put the output on a share drive, and then our Alteryx workflow will pick that up and then we can run with it. So Alteryx in the end has been a great partner for us with Tableau because we can prepare that data and we can leverage our Tableau visualizations for what they're intended to do. Ultimately, we drove a lot of productivity throughout our finance organization, but what was more is that more improved was the changes that we made within the business and how we change the dynamic of these meetings each week because they are more collaborative. So I've talked a lot about data, I've talked about HANA, I've talked about extracts, so I wanted to clarify a few points. Again, leveraging governed data is important to us, and we have a HANA data warehouse that is extremely powerful, and we want to be able to leverage that at all costs. So that's where we'll go to first. But if it's not giving us exactly what we need, we will turn to extracts. And the reason is that we have a busy IT organization, and they can't always make the changes in the timeframes that we need it. So we can take it on ourselves, and we can prototype, we can pilot, and we can deploy these solutions. And what's great about it is that we'll get affirmation on, did we do it right? Do we have the right information? Do we need to change something? And as we get that, we can then come back around to IT and have them make the modifications to our existing or create new HANA views that we can leverage going forward. So our data lifecycle truly is going around, starting from HANA, going to extracts, and then going back to HANA. Because again, I'm finance. I don't want to be administrating processes. I want to be developing new solutions and helping provide business insight. So with that, I will turn it over to Wendy Fosling.
All right, thanks, Joe. You guys hear me okay? All right, so I'm going to talk a bit about the science behind phishing. And when I think about phishing stories, my phishing stories aren't very good because I don't like to fish. I'm more likely to bring a book along. I would really like to do like the water clarity sampling and collect the data about that. That's the stuff. I'm kind of a geek. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how geeks like me use Tableau to help our process workflow. So one of the things that Stephen Levitt said this morning was right at the end of his talk. I wrote it down, and I think I want to make a t-shirt, or I want to use this over and over again. He said, the insights, get this right, the insights are inside of you, not found by bumbling around in the data. And I thought that was such a good tie-in to what we were going to talk about today, because I'm going to talk about the need for communication in data science, and how we use Tableau as a tool to do that communication. So first of all, I should actually tell you where I sit in the organization. I lead a data science team. We do projects across Honeywell. And one of our big challenges is communicating with the experts across those businesses. So Sherry talked about our UOP business. We've got people that have amazing knowledge. We've got thousands and thousands of engineers with domain knowledge in the industries that we work in. And our challenge is, how do we, as the people who are really doing the statistical modeling, the data manipulation, how do we communicate well with those experts? That's a large part of what I'm going to talk about today. Before I jump into that, one of the things I wanted to ask, how many of you checked your FICO score lately? Anybody check that regularly? I kind of checked mine after that Experian data leak. I just wanted to check on things. So the FICO score, that's an example of a predictive model. Right, and in that case, the FICO score helps lenders understand things about the consumers and what sorts of risks they might bring, what kind of benefits they might bring. And they've been doing that for about 60 years, so a long history of developing predictive models. And in order to develop those predictive models, they have to put together a set of characteristics. It's usually consumer behavior characteristics. Right, that are the inputs to those models, the ingredients for those models. Right? And so that's how you come up with a set of models that can predict how someone will do something in the future based on what they've done in the past. Now that's a large part of what our group does. We focus on developing predictive models. We have a little bit different domain. Right? We're looking at energy, safety, security, productivity, in the industrial manufacturing domains and commercial buildings. That's what we focus on. So I'm going to talk a bit today about how we use Tableau to help us develop our ingredients for those predictive models and some of the steps that we go through. All right, so let me jump in. So going back to the challenges we just talked about. Our customers want predictive models, and the reason they want that is mostly to make operations more effective. If you think about what happens in an oil refinery, in a commercial building, a lot of stuff can go wrong, right? And that's why there are maintenance staff and there are process engineers, there are people tending to this. There are probably, I can't even guess how many millions of square feet are in this complex, and there is an attentive facility staff that's paying attention to what's going on so that we stay comfortable. Same thing happens in an oil refinery or in any manufacturing plant. People are watching for stuff to go wrong. We don't always have to have people watching for it to go wrong. Right? The data can help us inform what is going on in the building, and that helps with the productivity, the comfort, the safety of those facilities and manufacturing plants. But there's some odd things about the domain that we work in. So I talked about the FICO score. And with FICO scores or other credit risk models, we typically know what happened in the past. We have markers, who defaulted on a loan, who paid well, who paid early, who maybe didn't pay 1 month, but they paid the next month. There's a lot of what we call outcome data. We know what happened. And the unusual thing in working in manufacturing is that data is a lot fuzzier. Right? So we might be looking for some characteristic that can become very expensive, but we don't necessarily have recorded data about when that happened in the past. So we do a lot of negotiation to find that information, because without some targets, it's really hard to create a predictive model because there's nothing to predict. So I'm going to talk about how we do that. And then I'm going to talk about sensor data. So when I'm referring to sensor data, it's things like the temperature in this room. So likely, I don't know whose control system's in there. I hope there are Honeywell systems in here. We could do some good things for them if they are. But, typically in a facility like this, there are a set of measurements. And if I scan around the room, I can probably find some of them. And there are measurements about the temperature, the humidity. Those are the sensor measurement, the types of sensor measurements that we work with. And those are typically recorded in some way over time, so we can watch the behavior. So a simple thing that we might look for, let's say in this facility, everybody's pretty comfortable, right? It feels comfortable for me, but I'm from Minnesota, so cold feels good. What's happening here is there's a whole set of equipment that's keeping this room comfortable, and its job, right, it is set up to keep it at a temperature that humans find comfortable. Now, back behind that, that equipment might be working at lower efficiency than it has in the past. It might be that things are running for 24 hours a day just to keep it comfortable on the ragged edge of being able to keep the room comfortable. That's the kind of stuff we watch for, right? Because it's a little bit of a secret. If we're all comfortable but the equipment isn't running right, nobody knows it, but the secrets are in that sensor data. So that's really the theme of what I'm going to show you today, is how we use that sensor data to come up with models, how we use visualization to help us work with that sensor data. So the key thing here is we've got to combine the domain knowledge that we have, right? I didn't grow up knowing things about how HVAC systems are interconnected. Domain experts helped me understand that, and that's a key thing that our group needs to do. So let's take a look. So I'm going to use this term ground truth, right? That's the outcome data. How do I know when something happened? How do I know when this room got too uncomfortable for people to be in it? How do I know when the air handling unit that's on the roof of this building failed? How do I know when the chiller had a problem? That's ground truth. I want to know that in order to be able to develop models. So we always need some type of ground truth. Some ground truth is super easy to get. What is this thing on the page? Nobody, I don't think anybody is going to tell me anything different than this is a dog. It's a cute dog. I have a golden retriever in my life. I love golden retrievers. Cute dog. So we didn't have any discrepancies about that. Most of the data that we look at looks more like this. This happens to be Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. Anybody recognize it except for Patrick because he knows? Patrick's on my team, but anybody recognize this as the Ninth Symphony? Not likely. All right, so this is what our data tends to look like. And so what we're trying to negotiate is we've got thousands of these experienced engineers, right, that can help us understand what to look for in that kind of a signature. But we're the data science team. How do we talk to them? So what we do is we put together visualizations. And here's an example of one with some dummy data in it. No real data was harmed in the development of this visualization. So we're doing a negotiation. In those weird-looking signals, there's actually some very, very valuable information. And the things that we have highlighted here, the blue lines at the top are normal operations. The red lines, the red bars across there are when we saw something unusual. We go through a process where we're sitting down with an engineer or a chemist, a process expert, that may have spent years of their life sitting with one of these plants in a refinery and knows exactly what to look for when they see it. But they can't really tell us very clearly. So we go back and forth with this kind of negotiation where they give us a guess, and then we try to write it down, we try to do a model, and it can be a very painful process. What we have been converting to increasingly is we have visualizations like this, where we will sit down with that process expert and we'll interview them with the data. All right, so it's not just asking about their expertise, it's quantifying and codifying their expertise with the data in front of them. And this has been an amazing improvement. When we're developing these models, one of the big questions we get asked is, how accurate are they? Well, I don't know how accurate they are until I've got this kind of information, but I also know that I can only get it from a process expert who is very time constrained. So we recently used some of this type of visualization. We've been able to crank through months of data, quantify it with a process expert, turn around and render it back to him and get his validation on it and greatly increase our productivity and the use of his time. And another interesting thing about that is these guys are typically really busy. They have jobs where, honestly, they may have fires to put out. My fires to put out are often involving PowerPoint, but their fires to put out are real. So they've got very stressful jobs. For us to keep them engaged is hard, right? And we have found that this method of pulling it up in a really well put together visualization where they can see the sensor data, they can talk to us about what's going wrong, annotate a turnaround to show it back to them, has been incredibly effective. Okay, so that's one way that we're using Tableau to accelerate our data science process. I'm gonna go into a little bit of a different example now. Everybody's got bad data of some type, right? Time series data sometimes has its own weirdness. And I want to stop for just a minute and talk about the process by which we develop models. I talked about ground truth because that's kind of a gate. We need to have that to develop any kind of a model. But typically, when we're developing a predictive model, we start out with understanding the problem, the solution crafting part of it. Right? Not just digging in the data. We don't do what Steve Levitt says not to do. We start out by understanding what the problem is. And then we get access to a set of data, and then we do a set of exploratory analytics. Not all that different from other domains, other types. You've got to do some exploration of the data. Just for us, it happens to be sensor data. And when we start that exploratory analysis, we use visualization very heavily. And the reason is you can uncover a lot of weirdness pretty quickly if you can take a look at it. So the example here, and one of the first things we have to do is remove the obvious junk. Right, and we saw some very nice things that are coming in the next versions of Tableau to help us filter out bad data. This is what badness looks like in our world. This is, I don't know if you can see from the back, but the values here for a sensor that is measuring, I believe this is temperature, are 10 to the 38th. Not likely, right? But it obscures everything else that's in the data. And when we pull it up in the visualization, it's very simple. We can go in there and say, okay, now we can write a rule to remove all this weirdness to our data and move on to the next step. All right, so then when we get to the next step, weirdness gone, what's the next thing that we need to do? So we're still in the exploration phase, and we're part of this ground truth. We've found a days of normal operation and days with unusual oscillations. So what we're trying to do here is differentiate these two. So this is how I'm just gonna start to get to a predictive model. I wanna find bad days, and I wanna find them early, because I wanna take what's in this lower chart, I wanna be able to route a message to the facilities manager and have them go fix the underlying problem with the equipment. So what we do is we go through this, and now we've found, as we review the trends and we've looked at the ground truth, some characteristics. I now start to have something that might be useful for a predictive model. Right. So, what do we do? So, data science, the next thing we're gonna do is we're gonna extract some features, and we're gonna look at how we can actually create models that are gonna do the prediction. So we ran our data through, and one of the things that comes to mind when you're looking at that kind of oscillation, if you're an engineer and have worked with some time series data, hey, let's transfer that to a different measurement system. We'll transfer it to the frequency domain and see what that gives us. And I'm not going to go through how we do that, but those transform signals are shown here in the two charts. We're bouncing back and forth between Tableau and a set of analytical tools. R and Python are our go-to tools. We'll do those calculations. We pull it back into Tableau, and then we evaluate. Can we actually differentiate the good cases from the bad? It kind of looks like it from this set of charts, but when we ran through it, and we ran through lots and lots of examples, we had, I think we had at least a year's worth of data that we were working with here. we found that it really didn't differentiate it all that well. Going back to that ground truth, right? We could go back and assess which days we had bad operation and did this particular transformation work. Answer was nope. So what do? We have to form a new hypothesis. So next thing we do is say, all right, well, let's take another approach at this. And I went to a talk yesterday. It was an IoT talk. And one of the things that the presenter was talking about was problems with over-engineering. And what we came to here is a really good illustration of that. That whole complex transformation we were doing was interesting, it didn't actually work, and one that was a heck of a lot simpler and easier to evaluate was far better. All we did was differentiate. We subtracted the one time sample from a previous time signal, ran that through, and what we found then is that the ranges that we had in the data worked really well to differentiate good days from bad day. And again, this is super easy to see if we can pull it into a visualization. If I just ran it and I ran some metrics and had a table, there's no way that this is as clear to those of us developing the model, nor our stakeholders that are involved in building the model with us, the process experts, or the ultimate stakeholder, the customer that's going to receive this. So I think about the visualizations as a communication tool. It's a fundamental communication tool for us in the data science process. Okay, so we were pretty happy with that. Now we build a model. So I'm going to hugely oversimplify things. We went off and created a model. Question in the back?
What is the color differentiating in the
chart? The two signals. This is, in this case, it is the raw signal and the process signal. So the measurement and its derivative. Thanks, good catch. So my huge oversimplification, we went off and built a model. And often this actually is the easiest part of the job, right? We go off and we've got all the features, we understood what they wanted to accomplish, we understood what the ground truth was, now we can build a model. So then again, we use visualization to help us evaluate if we picked up from the model the desired behavior, because our hypothesis was this new feature was gonna help us. And I will cut a long story quite short, right? We came up with something we're pretty happy here, and then we would go to production. So you've kind of seen the different steps there, what we did in exploratory analytics, how we use visualization in our feature extraction, how we use it in model development, and every time it's a communication tool. Helps us understand, helps our stakeholder understand. So we're happy, we go to production. So, moral of the story. You probably heard me say 5 times that communication is key in data science, and I'll say it a 6th time, right? This is critical to helping us understand and our stakeholders understand, and visualization is, we'll say unequivocally, it's the way to do it, right? We utilize Tableau very heavily to facilitate that communication, and it accelerates our process. Driving that consensus with our process experts is really, really hard, and we have made it much easier by using visualizations to do this. And you could talk with Patrick or I after the end here and just hear a little bit more detail about how painful that has been and how much of a change this has been for us. Optimizing that domain expert's time, we would not get their time of day. We had another data scientist struggling with that for quite some time, probably the better part of a year, really getting dedicated time. It needs to feel productive for that process expert, and that's what we've been able to do with our Tableau visualizations. So it gives us a better partnership, overall better results. So I talked at the start about FICO scores, right, and about things that go into those models. Those are really the ingredients for a predictive model. And what we use Tableau for is developing our ingredients for the predictive models in the Internet of Things space. And we're finding that this has helped us quite a bit with getting the right solution and getting to the right solution faster. And that is it. You can open up some time for Q&A. You guys want to come up and we can all do Q&A? All right, any questions?
Why did we choose to go to the visualizations versus?
For the extraction.
Why did you use So when we were using our Alteryx workflow, our server doesn't have a direct connection yet to our HANA tables, so we needed to get the data out. And like I said, we recognized that BO4 was there, and we were able to just do that. Schedule those Webby reports, the output goes on the shared drive, and then our workflow will pick it up.
That's an input.
Yep, yep. We're working through that. Making a direct connection to through Tableau as well?
Yeah.
Yeah, but we needed to, the issue that we had was that we had to use Alteryx to do more of the transformation. So we do the, we'll make a connection with Tableau, and we did that with our custom SQL, but when we started to blend additional information on those other inputs, that's where we had struggles with.
So you did it basically
That's correct, for transformation purposes. So the question is, are we using it for just reporting, or are we doing predictive analytics? The struggle that I have is that I am finance, and our finance peers are very overworked, so they immediately go to productivity-type projects. However, our business leaders are recognizing the tools that we have and the successes that we're seeing, and we are now transforming into more enhanced analytics and then working with other partners and peers across our company. We're able to find those that have the statistical and predictive insights, and we'll be transforming in that direction. So, yeah. Who's moderating? You moderate.
Go ahead. Trying to tie that together. We have two analytics.
You want to repeat it? You want to repeat it?
Oh, I'm sorry. You didn't hear that? The question is, we have a lot of different activities going on in the organization, and how do we tie it all together? I think that's the basis, right? So we have two different groups, an external analytics team and an internal analytics organization. So Wendy is part of the external analytics group, and I lead the internal analytics piece. So we have an analytics council where we try to coordinate our leadership amongst the council members. So we have a working team that is kind of a combination of IT and analytics leaders to coordinate on the activities that we need to do. And then we have a, I'm going to call it a representative group from the businesses that represent the demand side of analytics. Okay. So that helps us have, you know, specific organizational discussions about how do we bring all this stuff together at a more strategic level.
Let me add to that too. So we review these projects jointly. So if there are things that are internal things that come into the data science COE, right, we'll coordinate, and vice versa. And if there are predictive modeling needs, we look at how those can be met within the different COEs. So I think there's a pretty good flow of communication. That's the only way to make that work, right? Because we're all kind of caught up in the things that we're doing day to day, but we're aware of what the strengths of the other groups are, and try to make sure that we push and pull projects across appropriately.
You got to have the leadership and then that vision to work with others outside. I mean, the quarterly forecast I was talking about, we did a lot of productivity, and we're going into the second level. We're looking to build that all automated and then go into the predictive. And I've actually been working with another team member, Brandon, and his boss, who's in an analytics group, to help us with that. So that's where we can leverage their talents with our projects.
We had someone over here.
At this one,
yeah.
Go ahead. Okay. Very good, very good. Gentleman there. That's a great question, and I don't mean that in the way that they said this morning. No, actually, we are in the process right now of reviewing our sales incentive planning processes for working capital. So yes, we have had to think about that. It's not easy, but we're in the process of doing that right now. Sales has typically not been tied to working capital in Honeywell, so that is a big part of a broader transformation, right? How do you get more action? You incent people the right way. Where do we go next? I know over here.
This question is for Wendy. What do you use to do the modeling? What is the backend solution? Is it SQL? Is the data just coming from
Very good question. And the answer, of course, is it depends. With the volumes of data that we pull in, most of it is coming into some sort of distributed system like Hadoop. So the vast majority of the data that we're working in, like we're pulling in from the industrial internet, that lands in our Hadoop environment, or Hadoop environments. We've got a couple. But that's where most of it lands. And then we've got tools that will then connect up to those environments, including Tableau, to pull the data out and do the analysis.
I think we can take one more, and that's probably out of time.
I have a question for Sherry. You guys have a tremendous adoption rate in a very short time, and it sounds like there's some things and processes are intentionally set up to serve the entire organization, and there's some homegrown organic collaboration. Can you, at what year do you start that, or like what is the journey to acquire that?
Yes, so the question is really more around, I think the approach is, do we take a centered approach, or how do we enable the different parts of the organization, right? And I think Honeywell's too big to center everything. We could never make that work. So it kind of depends on your organization. But for us, we have to figure out ways to enable the businesses more effectively. So we typically have some centering capabilities, but we view those as how do we help standardize or share, drive community of practice type of activities. And then we have good community of practice leaders in the organization, in the businesses as well, that help coordinate those efforts. And that's worked for us.
What I might add is last year at Tableau Conference, we also presented and talked about that in some of our key activities. And so maybe check that on Tableau or TC16 and check that.
And I'll just add one more thing. Like for us in the Data Science Center of Excellence, and there's no way that that's centralized completely across the company either. We have explicit goals to enable and evangelize with the businesses. So if we're developing best practices, we push that out to the businesses and make it very collaborative. So everybody on my team has a goal around enablement and evangelization so that the COE is really serving that purpose.
And we help stand up training and things like that at the center so the businesses don't have to worry about that stuff. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.